Hello and welcome to Monterey Bay Academy's online streaming. My name is Daniel Gregory and I'm the worship and media pastor here at the church. Now if you're new to who we are, we welcome you. We're a youth-centered church based around, by, and for the students and faculty of Monterey Bay Academy. We have a proud heritage of serving our local community and our neighboring area. So, on behalf of our senior pastor, Tom Garner, and our principal, Jeff Deming, we hope you enjoy your time with us and come to visit us often. Feel free to stop in and visit when you're in the area. We'd love to have you. God bless.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I want to welcome you all to our program today, and I thank you all for being here. And please bow your heads for a word of prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for this weekend we could take to celebrate our class, and please be with the program today and help it to help whoever needs to hear it. And in your name, amen.
I would guess that if I were to ask the parents of our graduates here, there's probably a picture of their first day of school. Seniors, remember that? Yeah, getting dressed up, brand new set of clothing, probably a backpack full of brand new box of crayons, all that sort of stuff. Am I right out there, parents? Now, if you figure they did that in kindergarten with 180 days in a school year, that's 2,430 days of school that they've been to, and now we're here. So welcome to graduation at Monterey Bay Academy, the baccalaureate service. We are so glad you are here to be part of this program. Welcome to church, and welcome to worship.
Said you're always by my side, and I believe in you with all of my heart. My heart grows weak when I'm alone, and through the darkness covering me, you say my wounded soul I'm free. Happening in me, and love is real.
And love is real.
Love can heal.
And love can heal. You came with open arms. I see. You've made a miracle of me, oh
here.
Hello. Today's scripture comes from Isaiah 49, 15 to 16. Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you.
Una donna dimentica il bambino che allatta, cessando di avere pietà del frutto delle sue viscere. Quando anche le madri dimenticassero, non io dimenticherò te. È chiusa scolpita sulle palme delle mie mani. Le tue mura mi stanno del continuo davanti agli occhi.
I'll be reading in Portuguese. Porventura, pode uma mulher esquecer-se tanto de seu filho que cria, que não se compadeça dele, do filho do seu ventre? Mas ainda que essa se esquecesse dele, contudo eu não me esquecerei de ti. Eis que nas palmas das minhas mãos eu te gravei. Os teus muros estão continuamente diante de mim.
I'm going to read in German. Kann auch ein Weib ihres Kind eins vergessen, dass sie sich nicht erbarme über den Sohn ihres Leibes? Und ob sie seiner Gefäße, so will ich doch deine nicht vergessen. Siehe, in der Hände habe ich dich gezeichnet. Deine Mauern sind immer wie vor dir Döner.
I read in Vietnamese. Đàn bà hay quên con người cho bố, không thương đến con cha ruột mình sao? Dầu hầm bà quên con mình, ta cũng chẳng quên ngươi. Này ta đã chạm ngươi trong lòng bàn tay ta. Các tường thành người thường trước đứng ngực ta luôn.
I'm reading in Russian. Забудьте, женщина, дитя свое, чтобы не пожалеть сына чрева своего. Но если бы она и забыла, то я не забуду тебя. Вот я начертал тебя на дланях моих, стены мои всегда предо мною.
Good morning, church family. Today's offering will go to the Worthy Student Fund, which helps to aid students financially who can't afford to come to MBA. It helps support scholarships, anything from athletic scholarships to scholarships for academic excellence. And it helps so many students be able to come here today, and I'm part of one of those students. The Worthy Student Fund has really helped me and my family and so many of my friends come to NBA and have a really good experience. So I hope that you guys will keep that in mind and open your hearts up. Would the deacons please come forward? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity for us to all come here and celebrate these past 4 years together with love and compassion. Please bless this money and help it to go to the places that you believe it needs most. Thank you for all the blessings that the school has bestowed upon me and my classmates, and please help this money to help fund other students in the future who may come here. We love you so much. Thank you for your Sabbath. Amen.
Thank you. Hello. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Please stand if you're able.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Thank you.
before, oh my soul, I worship. Today, I have the privilege of introducing our speaker. I'm a three-year student here at MBA, and during these past 3 years, I've gotten to know this man pretty well. As a sophomore, I was terrified of him. And as a junior, I opened up to him a little. I would occasionally talk to him. But as a senior, I find myself wanting to spend even more time with him. And I'll cherish every moment I have with him, even when he caught me sneaking out, or when he tells me that being vegetarian is a waste of time. As you can tell, I'm talking about Dean Grady today. And Dean Grady has impacted my life so much here at MBA. He's made me laugh so many times. In fact, I started writing down a list of everything he says that makes me laugh. And here are a few quotes. You think I'm gonna tell you that lying is okay? It is. Give Nebraska away, we don't need it. And don't worry, Grady, I won't be saying anymore. But aside from making me laugh, Grady has had some serious talks with me too. We've talked about religion, plans for the future, and so much more. And I remember multiple times I'd ask him one simple question, and that one question would spiral into a 1 to 2 hour long discussion about whatever he wanted to talk about. And sure, yes, he does talk too much, but the fact that he's willing to spend time with us talking shows that he truly cares for us. He has a passion for steering kids into becoming young men and women that will make a difference in this world. And Grady tells us that he doesn't care how successful we are, he cares how much we want to be better people and how much we want to change the world. He wants us to prioritize helping others over anything. And I can speak for all the guys here that that's something that will stick with us forever. He has successfully inspired us to change the world for the better. And although it may be hard to tell, he's more than just a bald man who shoots us with Nerf guns. So I'm proud to introduce him today, not only as our speaker, but as our dean, mentor, role model, and friend, Greg Grady.
Good morning. There's a theologian that I'm very fond of that says, a text without a context is the sure sign of a con. So he's been recording stuff I've said for 4 years, and I probably said it. I either thought it was funny at the time, or it's going to come back and get me, I promise. It's going to. But it is. It's who I am. I'm a mess. I want to first off, before I go into all that, I want to thank all of you for being here, for trusting us with your kids. We don't take that lightly. I sure don't. And it is a task that I'm aware I'm not worthy of. Right? I know that I'm not up to the task. But I wake up, I go, and there's so many other people tirelessly working for that goal, is to see these young men. They come at 14, and they're just dumb, right? There's no other word. And just like, okay, you know, if I had a dollar for how often I'm just, you know, no hair, yeah, this is the thing. So they come, and your only hope, and if you take ownership, and I believe we do, we take ownership that they're your sons, they're your daughters, but they're ours. They are mine. If I lose that, I'll quit tomorrow. I'm already having trouble. So good. Every time I get up and talk, background, I will tangent all day, and I won't even be sorry for it later, just in case you're wondering. I hope your seat's comfortable. What's the temperature like in here? I'm burning up. I'm dying. I love cemeteries. That's odd. I bet you thought I was going a different direction there. I do. My wife and I, as some of you already know, because we just went on a vacation. My wife has never been to D.C. before. And I used to live near there. My parents, of course, we lived there for a few years. We went on this D.C. trip. This summer is our 25th wedding anniversary, and we've got so many other things planned with, you know, big family. I wanted like a private, you know, getaway kind of thing. I guess whatever you're supposed to do. I don't know. I was lost. So she'd never been. I was like, we had the space. Let's go. And so we visited D.C., had a marvelous time. It was also my 30th high school reunion. That will probably come back into the story later. Sorry. Yeah. And so we did. We went and saw the sites, and then at our last day before we were going to go off to my high school reunion, we stopped at Arlington National Cemetery. And if you've ever been, I've never seen anything quite like it. I'm sure there are many that are maybe bigger, but you're walking through just row after row after row of name, this guy, that guy, old, young, great. I mean, some of these stones are just ridiculous. And then some of these stones, you know, you have to get up right next to it to even read the title. And whenever I go, based on what background I've had and all the things and the way I look at theology and the way that I see my father, whenever I say my father, by the way, I mean God in heaven. Whenever I say my dad, he's sitting here somewhere in the crowd. Dad's here. Father's here. But that's what I'm talking about. Whenever I walk through the cemetery, all I see, follow me on this, is the glory of my father. I know it sounds bad because all of these, you know, it's death and it's final, it's all these things. And I'm going to get to the explanation a little bit later, but all I see is that guy. I don't know that guy's name. I wonder what he's like. What were his hopes? What were his dreams? What did he do? Was he good? Was he not? I don't know. I wonder what he was like. I bet he has got a million stories. And then right next to him, another guy. And then, of course, in Arlington National Cemetery, there's 10,000 in that direction. And there's 5,000 in that direction. And then there's an innumerable. And these are the headstones we know. The cemetery's only really been a cemetery since just after the Civil War. And so you've got this monstrosity. And as you walk in, all the people that are going in, there's an element of holiness there. Some of it's true, some of it I'm not so into. And you're just walking through the gravestones. And silent. I mean, there's all of these people, and it's silent. I think this all started for me when I felt, for one level or another, that I had arrived with all the goals that I really wanted. My wife and I had gotten married, and I had my first job. I bought my first car, a lot of firsts. Had our first house. All these things that you're told, you know, this is what you're... And so we have all these firsts, and as I'm growing as a human being, I'm still kind of feeling super empty. Like, I thought all of this was gonna do it. The job that you want, the girl you want, all of it. And I was still broken, and I was surprised to be broken. And so I didn't know how to deal with my frustration. And so right north of our house, it was less than a mile away, was a cemetery. And I've always been scared of the dark, and I just went anyway. And of course, this particular cemetery has these ridiculous large statues and then spotlights. And so I'm walking in there. I'd be walking over there at 10 p.m., full on dark. And, buddy, if that shadow moves. And, you know, so I'm terrified, but I start walking into the cemetery. And the same thing. I'm looking at all these names. In fact, one of my best friends stood at my wedding. His grandfather's there. His name is, anyway, sometimes you just look at somebody's name and you just shake your head a little bit. His name was Artery Hart. Not from a cardiologist family, and it's all spelled differently. I don't know. Do we think this? Anyway. And so I'd sit there talking to his grandfather, not really, but just sitting there, working through my life. And really, it always turned into prayer. It always turned into prayer. I'd start talking to my father. What is this? Why is this whole death thing? What is going on? I mean, it's almost like we just wipe it under the rug so we don't have to think about it. And that's probably good. Don't want to think about all the time, and I'm not trying to be dark. I was like, what's going on here? Why do I feel like this? I feel broken. That guy definitely feels the same way. And so we started this concept of prayer. We started this conversation in which I spent quiet, silent time among the graves with my father. And up till then, I never got it. until I heard, in a manner of speaking, I heard my name. I heard my name. I heard our name. You are my beloved. Beloved means you who are greatly loved. You are beloved. By the way, this is our job here at Monterey Bay. This is our job as Christians, and by God, we're terrible at it, I promise. I wish we weren't, and I'm sorry I said it just as frankly as I could do it. To teach the world that their name is beloved. That's our job. To teach you that your name, if you leave here and you don't know it, you failed. I don't care if you have straight A's. I failed. As if you're a son and you don't know that you're beloved, I failed. And I was there and I was learning this as I was sitting in the quietness of the cemetery. My name is beloved. My name. And then, of course, my eyes open up from here on out. I mean, I start reading scripture. It's totally different. I start seeing the world differently. The vision has totally changed. I am beloved. Wait a minute. What does that change? Wait a minute. How do I read this? All this kind of stuff. I started going through the scriptures after that. And I started finding these breadcrumbs that are just all through scripture. This boring book that I hated as a kid that was always used as a weapon, really, as a kid. And all of a sudden, now I see something. Whoa. And I start reading, and I read even the Old Testament has just gobs of this beautiful, romantic talk where God is like, you are mine, as you read today, which is hilarious. So I read a lot of, I have to apologize. The scripture that we read today is the scripture, kind of, that I wanted to say today. We'll get to that. I read all of the paraphrased Bibles. Those are my favorite. If anybody wants to argue later, I'm in. But it's always like, Psalm 16 to 19, or not 16, 17, right. So, that'll come back. I read Zephaniah 3:17, and I know you guys have heard, my boys in my dorm have heard this. When I read it, I was mad. I was angry. No one told me that. The Lord your God is with you. Well, I heard that. He's mighty to save. He takes great delight in you. Now, nobody ever told me that. He will quiet you with his love. He rejoices over you with singing. I've never thought of God singing over me. No one sings over me. I found Isaiah 49. Can a mother forget the infant at her breast, walk away from the baby she bore? But even if a mother forgets, I will never forget you, never. Look, I have written you on the palms of my hands. You are beloved. Your name is on the hand of God. The Aramaic in English, in plain English, is one of my favorite versions of that statement. It's similar. Behold, on the palms of my hands, I have engraved you. Yeah, daggum tattoo. Somewhere in my wayward youth, and there was a lot of wayward, I was very insecure and all this other stuff and added to it. And my parents are here and it's not on them. But as I got into my late teens and even at your age, my own name, Grady, I was ashamed of it. And I know that sounds really harsh, but I was. I was ashamed of me. I was ashamed, and of course, everybody has crazy in their family. We certainly have plenty and an extra helping in the Grady side. And I don't mean like the five of us. I mean the external of the Grady fans. There's several of them. And of course, that added to the narrative. I was ashamed of Grady. And of course, I added to it. I I had to narrow the stories down, so I'm going to tell you, I'm going to hopefully only tell you two. My sophomore year, Union College, me and my roommate, and we lived so that we could enjoy whatever. School was in the way of us having fun. No other way to say it. Which is why I probably get so riled up at some of you that do the same. And so at the end of the year, this is stupidity, and I can't stress this enough. I have no business being here. I may have mentioned that. Under my roommate's bed, there was a book, and it had been there for a while. There's some dust on it, whatever. I pull it out. I was like, whose book is this? And I was like, whatever. Of course, I'm a starving college student anyway. It's at the end of the year where you start turning books in. I found a book. My roommate's like, oh, this guy. He says, you should just turn it in. That sounds like a great idea. I turned that book in. Of course, to write your name, Brent Grady, behind a book that's not yours. $35, but that's Taco Bell all day. Back then, Taco Bell, you go pretty well for $3-4. Turn the book in. Sure enough, some deans were calling me down the very next day. What's going on? Turns out, full story, my roommate stole the book he just didn't like. A guy that we didn't like the whole year. Fine young man, whatever. Happy to meet him today, shake his hand, say sorry, of course, that's my go-to. He had that book missing. It had affected even his grade. He had to buy another, whatever. There was a long story I didn't even know of, and I have the book. Deans are right there. I'm sitting in front of them. And it just added to the story. What's the story? Grady. What does the name Grady mean? You know what the name Grady means? It means trouble. That's what that name means. It means, I don't know what the word is for whenever somebody walks in and they just shake their head and roll their eyes. I haven't found the English word that's what that means. That's what Grady means in very many parts of the world now. To add to this, his mom was the secretary of the department of the major I was having at the time. So I had to walk in and see her every time. And one time I went into her office because I needed something. And I don't know if you've ever been in front of somebody that absolutely is so annoyed that you're even in the room. But you have to talk to them, and then they have to talk to you, and they know it. I don't know whatever facial recognition or voice context you have to deal with, but let me know it. And I walked in, and she's at the desk, and I don't remember what I was asking for, and I apologized for my actions. Very good. But she was not having it. She was like, and of course, everyone knew I was dating Angela at the time, and Angela, her name means something altogether different than Trump. Her only vice is me. This lady actually just came out and said it. Most people are delicate here. Not at all. She's like, well, Angela dates you. There must be something good with you. That's exactly what she said. And I was like, thank you. I will go now. Years later, I'm working at summer camp. Love summer camp. Great. I always push summer camp. Great idea. The head of the summer camp, Pastor Ron Head, and the other guy, the assistant, were sitting there, and I'm laying in the lobby and whatever, and they're just looking at each other, looking at me, and they just start laughing. And they're just laughing the entire time. I'm like, okay, what? And then he tells me the story. He's like, you know what? When you first started working here, I called everyone at the high school. Because I was a senior, I was like, Dad, I need a job. Dad, I just moved out to Colorado. And I was like, Dad, I need a job. I'm moving out to Colorado. I don't know anybody. I don't know anything. I'm like, I need a job. Dad's like, well, let me see what I can do. I get this call, and they're like, hey, what about summer camp? Like, jet skis. I love jet skis. Who doesn't love summer camp? He's like, I went through your resume. I called every teacher we could find. They all said, do not hire him. Do not hire him. That was my legacy from Shenandoah Valley Academy, in case you wonder. Several years later, my son, Garen, my beloved, my son had a project, and he was writing down things about himself that he liked for this project. I don't remember any of them, but I do remember the last one. It still messes with me. Because that's this legacy I'm telling you about is my legacy, right? Even I look at myself and shake my head at me. I'm like, oh, this guy. And everyone around me, they can back that up. And he wrote down, I'm proud to be a writer. Oh, I was like, oh my goodness. I had a fundamental shift. Instead of looking at the world as to what I can get, because I was after that forever. I was that lost son. And I have a great father. I do. But I felt I had to do this on my own. And then I went away to boarding school at 14, a Christian Adventist boarding school just like this one. And I did not have people in my life that said, you are beloved, I'm going to work on this, you're not going to like it, we're doing it anyway. Because you matter. This is going to hurt a little bit, but I love you. And have that. I had people that rolled, whatever that English word, somebody afterward can tell me, that rolled their eyes, shook their head, and I said, I can't wait to get rid of this guy. I can't wait to get rid of writing. A fundamental shift. My son was proud to be a cry. I had never heard that before. It mattered. It changed. Oh, my goodness. Since then, and I fail at this every day, there's no way I can keep this perspective. This perspective that I'm beloved of my father and I don't deserve it, but he's mine and I am his. I need him because this is what love looks like, and we were never told this. He needs me too. God needs me. That's how love works. It's not a one-way street. I was a perfectly fine individual. I had married my wife. We had zero kids. Zero. I was wonderful. I was happy, kind of, all the time. And then we had Garen. Day one. By the way, I didn't want him, but I'm not going to get into that. Had nothing to do with him, just fundamental shift. I will die for you today, right now. What do you want? I don't feel like I have to have this argument with all the people in this room. Them, and they're the greatest thing on two wheels. They're sick. We're running. They need help. We run. That's what fathers do. That's what mamas do. Mamas don't forget. See, I've written you with indelible ink on my hand. I don't forget you. You're mine. You matter. And you have to know it. That is the gospel. There isn't another one. It's the good part of the good news. And it's not you matter if. No. You matter. Your problems are now my problems. Your joy is now mine. You are mine. And now you have your belovedness, now what? This is the failure of mainstream Christianity. We do not show the world. We do not prove to the world that they are beloved. They are my offspring. No, that's not what we do. Individuals all the time, every day. But as a general North American Christian whole, that is not what we do. We are not the most loving, the most kind, the people that run first. You have your high school diploma. You're off to the world. All of these facets, all these areas, and it doesn't matter what you do, where you go, each one of you being different, each one of you having different dreams and hopes and whatever. Still struggling with even who you are. Fine. Me too. Welcome. You've been called, though, to show the world that they matter. How you do it, I can't answer. My father knows all about it, but I can't answer. You've been called for this one thing, and it could be through art and music and studying biochem, sure. I've said this over and over to the boys. I sure hope that if you make wells in sub-Saharan Africa, I mean, can you imagine these little tiny things? It could be anything. Maybe you make a component to a well. I don't care. And this well is made in sub-Saharan where they struggle with even clean water, right? And then all of a sudden, the infant mortality rate drops from 37% to 17% because you built a well. That's all you did, right? It doesn't matter. That's all you did. They matter. You matter. Belovedness is in the face of all of us because it's on the hand of the one that said so. You are called to be great men and women. And what makes you great is that you show the world that their names are beloved too. Or I'm not sure you'll be great. Your name matters. What will your name, mean? I always ask for, with the boys, a moment of silence. Not all of my boys in my dorm believe the way I do, and I want to be open to that. So if you would, bow your head. My father, I fail. I have failed. But I pray that I'll hear your name. I pray that these people in this room will hear you call them beloved, and it will change our lives, our vision. We'll have hope. You've called us loved. And I pray, Father, that as we leave here, that we'll tell the world with our actions, the way that we act, the way we carry ourselves, that they are loved too, and no other end. And I pray this in the name. Amen.
Thank you, I don't know where he went, but thank you, Dean Grady, for your wonderful words that you spoke for us today. Will you please bow your heads and close your eyes for prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for giving us a new life. Thank you that you brought us to our graduation weekend and kept us together. As we go our separate ways, help us to remember the love and joy that was given to us here at MBA. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.